Hello everyone, welcome back to the series An Introduction to 2D Materials, Episode 1, Part 3. In this section, we will finally go over the transfer of already exfoliated flakes. If you haven't seen Part 1 or 2, please check those out first. As I've done in the first half of the episode on the exfoliation methods, I have taken the liberty to separate the transfer methods into three categories. First is the pickup and release of 2D flakes using another 2D flake. Second is the direct transfer of 2D flakes using polymers. And finally, we will finish off with the transfer of electrodes. The first class of transfer techniques is the van der Waals pickup and release techniques. The underlying working principle of these methods is that you use a van der Waals flake, which is already picked up, to pick up the subsequent layers of the stack. The first three are the most common, where the thermoplastics such as polycarbonate, polypropylene carbonate, or polycaprolactone attached to a PDMS block are used to first pick up the first flake. The biggest differences between them are the adhesion properties and the working temperatures. The first van der Waals layer is picked up by bringing the sample temperature close to the glass transition temperature of the polymer. The polymer films are brought into contact near the glass transition temperature, which allows them to be molded into the shape of the 2D flake, significantly increasing the van der Waals interaction between the polymer and the flake. Then, the polymer is slowly retracted, taking along with it the flake. The subsequent layers are quote-unquote easier to pick up, because typically the van der Waals interaction between the 2D layers is stronger than between a 2D flake and silicon dioxide. The last method uses water vapor as the adhesion layer instead of polymers, and can be useful if you are dealing with materials which do not degrade in the presence of water. For example, the first three methods can be used in a glove box with controlled atmosphere, while this method cannot. But if you're strictly working with HBN and graphene or any other air-stable 2D materials, then you don't really need to work in a glove box anyways. At the end of this talk, I will briefly highlight my opinion with regards to these polymers. Next is an upgrade to the van der Waals pickup technique, where instead of a block of PDMS, a dome-shaped PDMS is used. The geometry of the dome structure allows better control over the pickup without affecting the rest of the substrate. If a block is used, then a large area of the substrate, which may have several other viable flakes, is also put in contact with the polymer layer, which may introduce dirt, residues, or strain. However, if a dome is used, the contact area is significantly reduced, allowing the user to use other flakes on the same chip later on. In this paper, the authors already report on the fabrication of twisted bilayer graphene with controlled twist angles, which was a necessary step for the discovery of magic angle graphene. There are several adaptations of this PDMS dome technique. I will go over three of those now. First method is shown in this work, where they utilize the fact that PC has a poor adhesion to PDMS. They take advantage of the micro-tenting effect arising from the PC being peeled away from the underlying PDMS, and use this as a fine tip to pick up a flake that is in a densely packed area. This looks like it was an accidental discovery, because PC peeling away from PDMS happens quite often and I hate it. But the authors of this work managed to turn that disadvantage into a creative solution. The second adaptation I want to show you is where they make one more dome less than 1 millimeter wide on top of the original dome in order to improve the precision. They show in this graph that curing the PDMS upside down allows the microdome to have higher heights and therefore larger curvatures. Finally, this work takes it one step further by making a third dome, which is only 30 microns wide in diameter. They cover this microdome with PVC, which is used as the adhesive polymer here, to manipulate 2D flakes. As you can see in these images, they are able to flip, fold, and rip the flakes. They also showed in the paper that they can drag one flake across another to iron out the bubbles. The amount of control over the 2D flakes the author showed in this work is quite impressive and unprecedented. The second class of transfer methods is by using the polymers directly without the 2D flakes. I decided to first show the van der Waals pickup technique using HPN because that is easier and these methods rely on the same principles as in the van der Waals pickup techniques. The first transfer technique is called the wedging transfer technique, which was also developed in Delft. A thick layer of a hydrophobic polymer, cellulose acetate butyrate, is coated on top of exfoliated graphene. Then this chip is slowly immersed in water. Due to the hydrophobicity of cellulose acetate butyrate, the film along with graphene is peeled away from the hydrophilic silicon dioxide and is left afloat on water. This layer is then kept in position using probe needles, while the water is siphoned out until the flake meets the underlying substrate. This is similar to the method covered earlier where the 2D material was exfoliated onto PMMA on AquaSave, and AquaSave was dissolved, leaving the polymer and graphene floating on water. Next, I'm simply comparing the two most popular polymers used for pickup techniques, which are PPC and PC. PPC has a lower glass transition of around 40 degrees Celsius, and it has a relatively low adhesion, such that you can leave the flake down without leaving puddles of polymer residues. However, one should note that even though optically it doesn't seem like there's any residues, scanning electron microscopy and atomic force microscopy quickly reveals that there is about a nanometer thick layer of residues left behind after the transfer. These residues, however, can be easily removed by solvents like dichloromethane, thermal annealing, or oxygen plasma. Also, even though there is some level of residues, it is still several orders of magnitude less than the puddles left behind from PC transfer. These facts make PPC a great transfer polymer to transfer 2D or complex oxide flakes that are more than several nanometers in thickness. The disadvantage of using PPC is that it is not as sticky as PC and therefore cannot pick up monolayers. And even if you tried, it would cause too much stress to the 2D flakes due to the large thermal expansion coefficient. Earlier on in my PhD, I tried transferring MOS2 WSE2 heterobilayer using bare PPC, and it ripped the TMDs to pieces every attempt. PC, on the other hand, has a higher glass transition temperature of around 147 degrees Celsius. Because it is stickier than PPC, it can pick up really thin flakes, even monolayers. But as a result of the stickiness, it tends to leave large puddles of PC residues. What you see here on the top right is a puddle of PC after an attempt to clean it away using a thermal annealer. Before the annealing process, the amount of residue was even worse. PC, similar to PPC, can also be thermally incinerated, but requires the presence of oxygen. Therefore, annealing should be performed in air, but the combination of air and high temperatures is usually not suitable for many materials. As you can see, after several hours of annealing in air, most of the PC residues were gone from the active area. However, the act of annealing in air caused the palladium electrodes to also create oxides on the surface. The areas covered by HPN, however, were somewhat partially protected. The final class of transfer methods we will look at is for the transfer of electrodes. In these methods, instead of transferring the 2D material onto pre-patterned electrodes, pre-patterned electrodes are transferred onto the 2D flakes. There are several instances when this route should be considered. So let's take a look at these techniques in detail. As I mentioned before, directly evaporating metals on top of 2D materials can severely damage the 2D flakes. The cross-sectional TEM image here beautifully illustrates how damaging this process can be. When the gold is peeled away after being deposited onto a TMD material, it takes away with it the pieces of the flake. In comparison, when the gold electrode is transferred on top of the flake, the TMD is not damaged, and later on, peeling the gold again away from the flake causes no harm to the flake. Again, analogous to the previously discussed methods, since the metal is evaporated onto an atomically flat silicon, the bottom sides of the metallic electrodes are also atomically flat and contact TMDs with the Schottky-Mott barrier at the quantum limit. On the right, you see a similar method where a surface-assembled monolayer is used as a coating on the substrate to allow the metallic layers to be peeled off easily. The last method I want to discuss is the via method. Similar to the vias in PCBs, where holes are drilled to connect the copper lines of different layers together, the van der Waals vias connect the encapsulated 2D materials with the external world. In this method, the topmost HBN is pre-patterned by etching and evaporating the contacts. Then, the HBN, along with the via contacts, are assembled with the rest of the 2D stack, encapsulating the material of interest in between. Finally, the via contacts are connected to the rest of the leads by lithography. This method is quite powerful because it allows the encapsulation and contacting in one step, and allows the encapsulation and contacting of air-sensitive materials, which may react with air during the electrode patterning step. To finish things off, I've summarized my opinion and thoughts on different transfer methods here. I have limited experience with PCL, so I need to do some tests myself, but I've had great experience with the first three methods. With that, I conclude the first episode of An Introduction to 2D Materials. In this three-part episode, we took a look at various exfoliation and transfer methods. I hope you enjoyed these videos, and I also hope that they may help you one day in your research. If you have any recommendations or requests on what I should cover in the future, please leave a comment down below. If I have the expertise to cover that topic, then I'll try my best to make that video. Thank you for your attention, and see you next time.